for my world to live. Yours must die.
Hey, what's up, y'all? It's B-Avery here for another film review. Transformers The Last Night, the fifth Transformers movie in this franchise. Is it any good? Are you excited? Are you absolutely sick of these movies? Well, let's dive into this one. My name is Brandon Keith Avery, and this is just my opinion. So, believe it or not, once upon a time, Michael Bay was my favorite, most popular director out of all the directors. I loved him. If Michael Bay's name was attached to that film, I was going to go see that movie opening weekend. I mean, I love The Rock. I love Bad Boys 1 and 2. I love Armageddon. I really thought The Island was good. I love Transformers, the first one. I thought the action in Pearl Harbor was great, but everything else in that movie was bad. But, you know, you can't knock everyone out of the park. But Michael Bay was my very favorite director out of all of them. Even knocking out Spielberg. I mean, he's a better director, but Michael Bay was my favorite until Transformers Revenge of the Fallen came out. And then after that, you know, he just started becoming less and less likable to me. Like I said, I love the first Transformers. I have that on Blu-ray, but once Revenge of the Fallen came out, you know, I just kind of gave up hope. And it seems like, you know, I love the first Transformers. I thought Revenge of the Fallen was a hot garbage piece of trash. Transformers Dark of the Moon, the third one in the franchise, I thought that was okay. I absolutely hated Transformers Age of Extinction, and I have a copy of it, Blu-ray 3D IMAX. And the only reason I have this is because I did get it for cheap, and also, as you see on the Blu-ray, it says IMAX 3D. And to give credit where credit is due, Michael Bay is the king of IMAX. He's been trying to do IMAX for the longest. And when you're in a real theater, a real IMAX 70mm theater, when that screen expands and you get that resolution, it's like an experience you've never, you know, seen before. So, you know, I do like the technical things that he does, but that movie really did suck. But I always drink the Kool-Aid when these Transformers movies are about to come out. I mean, I'm not looking forward to them, but then the trailers come out and I'm like, you know, who knows? And I drink the Kool-Aid and I get all excited and I always get let down. But I was like, no, I'm not going to be tricked anymore with The Last Night. I don't care. This plot, this premise, this story just looks stupid. It seems like they're just kind of erasing everything that came before, and Optimus Prime is going into space, and we got Nazis and Winston Churchill and, you know, Merlin and the 12 Knights of the Round Table, and, you know, just like them in England back in the Dark Ages. This whole thing just seems stupid, and I was not going to drink the Kool-Aid, but like a couple of days before the movie came out, you know, I still did get a little bit excited. Now, I'm going to go ahead and get the great things out of the way that I did like about this movie. And the great things that I liked about this movie are slim to none. There is one little robot. I cannot remember his name because the movie, I don't want to say that right now. But there is like a little robot that's in the trailers that's the size of a human being. He was funny to me. I laughed my ass off a number of times when he was throughout the film just doing silly things that really didn't relate to his character. Well, I guess they did, but you can tell that they didn't just flow naturally. You know, this guy was trying to make jokes, but it was funny. It seemed like I was the only person laughing in the whole theater. But just going to the, you know, just talking about what Transformers is about is, you really should have called this movie Transformers Search for Another MacGuffin, because that's all these movies are, is just chasing MacGuffins after MacGuffin after MacGuffin, doing the same thing over and over again, and it's really getting tired, old, and boring. And what I mean by MacGuffin is, in the first Transformers movie, Transformers 1, or just Transformers, the MacGuffin in this film was the Allspark, the cube, you know, that Optimus Prime was talking about in the beginning. The second movie, Revenge of the Fallen, which I don't own on copy, that was the MacGuffin in that one was the Matrix of Leadership. And then the third film, they had a MacGuffin that, you know, was bringing Cybertron over to take over Earth. And then the fourth film, Age of Extinction, the MacGuffin was that sea thing. And it's just like, I mean, you keep having all these MacGuffins. You thought the cube and the Ozpark was the ultimate power. But then the next movie, they bring something else in that's supposed to be the ultimate power. And it just kind of dilutes everything. Like, okay, what was special about the first MacGuffin or the last three, four, or five if they just keep making stuff up as long as they go? I mean, part 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 is going to be a MacGuffin over here, MacGuffin over there. And I'm just really getting tired of that. And then this film, last night, there's two MacGuffins. One of them is his staff and one of them is his talisman, but you can't find the staff unless you find the talisman. And it's just like, this is just ridiculous. And you know, I'm really getting tired of it, and it just really getting old. But the premise of this whole movie is that the Transformers are on Earth, and they date back way, way, way back in the day before we thought they did. I mean, we thought that they dated back, you know, in the first one, into like a few decades ago when the cube crashed and they built the Hoover Dam around it. Then in Dark of the Moon, you find out that the Transformers dated even further back because they crashed upon the moon. But now, no, they've in this film, they've dated back 1600 years. And the only thing that I think is cool is, you know who Merlin is and King Arthur and all those people right there. They tried to play it as that Merlin was one of the people that, actually, I don't want to spoil it for you, but instead of Merlin using real magic, he was using the power of the Transformers. And then they tried to make every notable figure in the past 1600 years that are in a textbook that they had to do with, you know, the Transformers. And I mean, that is kind of neat, but at the same time, it puts plot holes in all the other films. Because let's look at Dark of the Moon, for instance. Cybertron was teleported over across the universe and was about to, I guess, destroy the Earth. So don't you think the cat needs to come out the bag then, you know, doing that movie? I mean, if the world is about to end, but no, this so-called secret society still just wants to hide in the shadows and let the world perish. I mean, that's just one plot hole that gets put in the past and this movie that, you know, and that's just one of many. There's just too many plot holes. But let me just talk about the characters. Michael Bay still finds it necessary, or the writers. And the writers in this film are Art Markham and Matt Holloway. And there's like seven other writers too that I don't want to look up. And what's surprising is these guys also get credit for the screenplay of Iron Man 1. And I really did love that film. But Michael Bay and the writers, what they decided to do with the characters, I just don't understand. The movie is called Transformers. We want to see Transformers, and we don't just want to see them. And we don't want to just see them in action. We want to see them getting along with each other and interacting and see their personalities and see what they love and what they care about. But no, we don't get that. We get more stupid characters that we don't care about, and the film focuses too much on them. Yes, the film needs to open up with some type of, you know, backstory to give us the gist of what happened back in the day. But as soon as it gets to the character, human beings, it doesn't focus on any characters that we know from the past. You get this little girl that we don't care about named, what is her name? Isabella Moner is her real name. And in the film is Isabella, and the black guy named Jimmy. Jimmy, I did not like his character at all. And I did not like Isabella's character at all. Jimmy is just, every word that comes out of his mouth is he's screaming and he's yelling, and everything else that comes out of his mouth is a joke. No matter if he's sitting down, if he's running, if he's on the computer, or, you know, I can understand you screaming and yelling if you're being chased by robots, but every single thing that comes out of his mouth, he's screaming and yelling across the room, and I don't like that. Stop making jokes out of everything. And, you know, even when he's in peril, when he's about to die, he still has room to try to fit in some joke. And it's just like, there's no threat. I don't feel that you're in danger. I don't feel that you're about to die because you're making jokes every 5 seconds. I mean, every situation that he's in danger, bullets, explosions, what rocks flying everywhere, he's going to make it. He's just somehow just a regular human being with no powers or no type of military training or combat training. He's able to wiggle his way in and out of the situation. And it goes for the same exact thing with the character Isabella. She was a cool character, but they tried to get you to care about her before you got to know her. Because she's trying to explain to Mark Wahlberg's character, Kate Yeager, what she cares about in her backstory. And she's emoting to her. I'm like, I don't know you. I just met you 5 minutes ago. So why are you crying? Am I supposed to feel sorry for you? And then I guess in the power of feminism and woman empowerment, which I have no quarrels with. I mean, I like strong women in these films. In any film or any form of entertainment. We need strong men. We need strong women. But her role just seemed completely out of place. When you're going over the board to try to prove how tough you are, it just makes you an unlikable character. You're only like 13, 14 years old with no weapons, no training, but you feel like you can run up on five Decepticons and they're not doing anything. I'm not afraid of you. I mean, I understand that you're not afraid, but you're trying to join this party and you don't know what's going on and what they have planned and you're messing up the whole plans. And it's just like, why are these characters here? I mean, I don't want to see human characters for the most part anyway. I want to see robots. I want to see Transformers. And then when you give me characters, at least give me characters that I like, but I don't like these characters at all. It's just frustrating, and I wanted her to get off the film, off the screen. Something else that frustrates me is the Transformers that we know. And I don't even know their names. I'm not going to look them up. There's one Transformer that he was in the last one. He's real fat with the beard. And why are Transformers fat with guts? That doesn't make sense. Why do Transformers have beards? Why do Transformers smoke cigars? I mean, it doesn't make sense. I don't know. The only characters I care about is Optimus Prime and Bumblebee. All the other Transformers are just no-name robots that change color from the last film to this one with no type of consistency whatsoever. I mean, they're just dancing. For example, the Dinobots, they've just been, you know, reduced down to, you know, junkyard guard dogs or whatever. I mean, just these epic warriors that have all these abilities just hanging around the junkyard with nothing else to do but do ballerina poses on top of a car, which is sword. And that's just not appealing for me at all. And let's just also get into the things that don't make sense in this film, because there's a buttload of them. I mean, you see in the trailers that there's this one planet that's going to come and devour Earth. And the whole Earth knows about this, but decides to do nothing but wait on the Transformers or wait for them to get there. I mean, this movie focuses a lot in America, and we have a lot of nukes. Why not team up with everybody and just launch every freaking nuclear bomb off into space to blow this thing out of the sky? It's a dead planet anyway. But you don't want to do anything. You just want to wait for it to get there. Even if you don't want to use nukes, you can get every fighter jet in the planet to just start blowing this thing out of the sky. But nope, nobody wants to do that. They just want to let it come in and just take over the planet for no particular reason. It just doesn't make sense. And, I mean, Transformers Age of Extinction was just super duper offensive to me on so many levels. It was just ridiculous. I mean, Optimus Prime flying off into space at the last frame of the movie, I'm saying to myself, why didn't you do that the whole time during the very beginning of the movie when they was at the barn or during the last action scene when, you know, you told one person, hey, get the seed out of the city. Why don't you grab it yourself and fly your butt out of there or give it to the Dinobot that flies out of there? Plot holes that don't make sense like this, the exact same thing in this movie here. I mean, we have Transformers and human beings that flip sides on what side they're on three times back to back in a 60-second, you know, sequence. And it just makes, I mean, you got these one people that are chasing Transformers. And then as soon as they find the Transformers, they're like, okay, we're on your side. Then you have Transformers that are fighting Optimus Prime. And say he's a bad guy, he's a traitor, and then he says one thing, and then they switch sides, and they're on his team. I mean, like, who is on whose side here? What's going on? Why don't you guys just all work together in the beginning? And just things that don't make sense with the plot is, if the whole thing is just a stupid chase sequence to where the Autobots are trying to find the device, and the humans are trying to find the Autobots, and then the Decepticons are chasing the humans. And they're leading the bad guys to the weapon. I mean, they didn't have to do that. All they had to do is just not do anything. But for some reason, they're not using their brain. They're not using their noggin. And they're just continuing to leave. I mean, they're helping this whole time. They're helping the bad guys out. And that just does not make any sense to me. I mean, leave the stuff at the bottom of the sea. Why bring it up? Why emerge it from the sea so that the bad guys get it? I don't know. I don't understand. I mean, if someone is trying to destroy the Earth, I'm not going to go help them out. I'm not going to give them the tools they need to succeed. But this film here just wants to ignore all of that. I mean, it's just plot hole, plot hole, plot hole, you know, one after another. The movie feels extremely long, coming in at 2 hours and 29 minutes. And they could have given, you know, the transition from part A to B, the beginning to the end of this film, they could have easily shut off, sliced off a good 45 minutes to an hour. And this film would have been a lot better. There is too much fluff in this movie that doesn't make sense. Sir Anthony Hopkins, he's in this movie too. He does an okay job. You know, he's not going to win any Oscars here. And Mark Wahlberg and the character, you know, his character, Kate Yeager, and his other counterpart, Laura Hadda, who plays Vivian Wimbley. Neither one of these characters match the role that they're trying to film. It still doesn't make sense that Mark Wahlberg is this super duper inventor, and they try to make sense of that. And then also, I really just didn't buy Miss Wimbley as the smart PhD person, you know, that she tried to portray. Nothing in. And, you know, I don't want to see any comments hating on what I just said, saying, oh, beautiful women can't be smart. Of course they can. I know plenty of them. But if you see this movie, you'll see what I'm talking about, is how they don't, it doesn't match. It doesn't add up to me. It's not believable. But something else that just was incredibly stupid to me is the world is about to end and everybody's about to die. And there is destruction and chaos and bullets everywhere on Ground Zero. But you have Sir Anthony Hopkins there with the pistol trying to shoot people. And then you also have Jimmy and Isabella too. Like, hey, I brought the Autobots. What are you doing there? They're just running in the middle of the battlefield. But they're not even fighting. They're just running alongside the people that have the guns. They're running alongside the Autobots. With no weapons, they're just there running. I mean, like, what are you doing here? Why are you here? This is just pointless. I mean, guys, this movie is just not good. It is offensive to all five senses in every way imaginable. It is better than Age of Extinction because that took it a little far as far as stupidity. But this is just not a good movie, and I did not enjoy it. For the most part, I was waiting for it to be over. And, you know, I can't even say I'm disappointed because my expectations were extremely low. So I'm gonna go ahead and rank these Transformers films from worst to best, just so you can have an idea of how I feel. Coming in last place, a film I absolutely hated, you probably give this like a 1 or something out of 10, is Transformers Age of Extinction. That thing was freaking garbage. Coming in at number 4, which I did not like at all either, was Transformers Revenge of the Fallen. Coming in at number 3 is the movie that we're talking about today, Transformers The Last Knight. Very bad movie, didn't enjoy it. It was just, you know, ridiculous and all the... I mean, like, the more I think about it, the more frustrating it is, because the one thing that Michael Bay did better in this movie than the last, Age of Extinction, is... he threw a few things at you in Age of Extinction that didn't make sense, but it was only a few, so you can actually sit there in a theater and pick out how much it didn't make sense. Transformers The Last Knight, he throws everything at you from every which way possible. It's just so much to digest. And when you're trying to, like, okay, does that make sense? If they can do this, why don't they do that? If they're trying to accomplish this, why don't they do this? But it's just so much that you can't even comprehend it in the theater while you're watching it. So you just kind of say F it and just accept it. But, you know, as I'm thinking about it now, it just doesn't make any sense. But Transformers The Last Knight comes in at number 3. Transformers Dark of the Moon, which I have here, 2 copies, 1 Blu-ray, 1 Blu-ray 3D with the IMAX because I got it for cheap and one of them was for free, comes in at number 2. And, of course, the first one, I love this movie. This is like a 9 out of 10 for me. This was amazing. Comes in at number 1. If I had to rate Transformers The Last Knight out of a 1 out of 10, I would give it a 3.5 out of 10. Yes, a 3.5 out of 10. But guys, that's just my opinion. Have you seen Transformers The Last Knight? Do you want to see Transformers The Last Knight? Have I turned you on? Have I turned you off? Do you agree with me or do you disagree with me? Let me know in the comment section below. Let's get this conversation going and keep it flowing. And guys, help me out. I really do want to go to the red carpet premiere of Black Panther that comes out next year, February of 2018. It comes out in Black History Month. I'm black. It's a black character, Black Panther, which I love. I love Marvel and I love comic books. So guys, it would just be a dream come true for me if I could go to this red carpet. It is not just a movie for me. It is a movement. And I just cannot wait to get there. Is it a long shot? Yeah, who knows? but I'm going for it. So help me out and get there by sharing this video 1,000 times. And if you like this video, go ahead and give me that thumbs up. And if you don't like the video, that's fine. Just leave me a comment below why and still give me the thumbs up. Since you're watching me here on YouTube, go ahead and subscribe to my YouTube channel so you can get all the content that I have to provide and help me reach my first milestone of 1,000 subscribers. You can also go to the website, check me out there, bookmark it, and also look me up on social media. But guys, I just want to thank you again for tuning in for my opinion/review for Transformers The Last Night. And before you go, don't forget that my name is Brandon Keith Avery, and that's just my opinion. Peace.